climax of the age, to unify all things and head them up and consummate them in Christ, both things in what?
Heaven.
And things in what?
Earth.
So what does Jesus want to do? What does it mean he planned in the maturity of the times, the climax of the age? The word here is, it'll say in the dispensation, is a word called oikonomia. It means house management. Amen? It really means put your house in order because Jesus wants to come to you. Prepare yourself to receive him. Hallelujah. Prepare yourself to receive him. He's coming.
Amen.
He's coming.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. He's coming. And so he's talking about humming, and we're talking about earth revelation and heaven revelation. Now watch this. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28. When we looked at Hebrews 12, 26, and we were going a little further, go with me to Hebrews 12, verse 26, actually verse 27 and 28. And when we begin to look at this in Hebrews, you begin to see what was happening. Now watch this, Hebrews chapter 12, amen, verse 27. He says in Hebrews 12, verse 27, yet once more donates the removing of those things that can be shaken. Amen. As of created things, so that those things which cannot be shaken may remain and continue. Let us therefore receive the kingdom. Amen. What does it say? Let us therefore receive a kingdom that is firm and stable and cannot be what? Shaken. Wow. Let us what? Receive the kingdom. Now watch this. Do you understand what this means? Let me give you the difference. Because this is very important. The kingdom of God is the rulership or the reign of God. What is the kingdom of God? We are receiving a kingdom. What does it say to receive a kingdom? Who understands what it means to receive a kingdom? To receive a kingdom. Now you can write this down. There's a difference between, I want you to write down, there's like three levels in the sense of revelation that comes to people. You have what you call the kingdom of God is near, the kingdom of God is upon you, amen, and the kingdom of God is in you. Who understands the difference? The kingdom of God is near, the kingdom of God is upon you, and the kingdom of God is in you, amen. The kingdom of God is near, the kingdom of God is upon you, and the kingdom of God is in you. Now let me explain the difference. He says, receive a kingdom. A kingdom. Let us therefore receive a kingdom. Amen. So what does he mean by receive? Let us come. The word to come. Amen. The kingdom of God has come. This word receive is actually the word erkomaia. Now this word erkomaia is really simple. I love this word. It means from one dimension to another. To call or to beckon for something. It comes from that part of the Bible says, Jesus says, pray like this. Remember the prayer Jesus said? Thy kingdom what? Come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Who knows what the will of God is in heaven? Is anybody sick in heaven? Is anybody got any pain in heaven? Is anything? Why does God say, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven? Is anybody depressed in heaven? Is anybody worried in heaven? Is anybody anxious in heaven? All my experiences of going to heaven and having an encounter with heaven, I never saw anything like that. Hallelujah. The voice of revelation literally declares the kingdom of God into manifestation. You have to understand that the voice of revelation literally declares the kingdom of God into manifestation. When we get a revelation, something goes, yes, I know it, it's mine, I've got it. Wow, I never saw that before. It does something to you that's powerful. Now remember, you've been born into the kingdom. No one can come into the kingdom of God unless they've been born again. No one can come into the kingdom of God unless they're what? Born again. Think about that. No one can come into the kingdom of God unless they're what? Born again.
Amen.
Hallelujah. No one can come into the kingdom of God unless they are born again. Amen. So this will really help you to understand how this works. Born into the kingdom. Now this is very important because when you enter something or you step into something, you begin to realize what you have. So the kingdom of God is near. Now, what do we mean by the kingdom of God is near? Someone said, well, what's the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God is what? Righteousness, peace, and what?
Joy
in the Holy Ghost. So if the kingdom of God is near, what does that mean? The authority of God is near. The rulership of God is near. The rule and authority of God is near you. Wow, I feel it. I can feel it. Man, that guy's not normal. When he comes around, it's like God's rule and authority is around. Hallelujah. Something is different. Why? The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. So when you feel righteous, you feel peace, and you feel joy coming from other people, coming from around you, you know you're in a kingdom family. You know it is what? Near. And so we want to have that righteousness and that peace and that joy near. It's kind of like I've shared before with you, with any kind of revelation. If you put your toe into the river and go, oh, I feel a little joy, or you go knee deep in the river or waist deep in the river of that revelation, or go swimming in the revelation. Well, it depends on how much you listen. Amen. The more you hear, the more you understand, the more you're able to comprehend, the more you're able to receive it. Amen. You almost got to go swimming in it. Okay, God, I'm going to take it all in. I'm going to absorb it like a sponge. Keep in mind, the memory of the righteous is blessed. The memory of the what? Well, who do you have living inside you? You have an unction from the Holy One who knows all things. You have an anointing that abides in you and teaches you all things. 1 John 2:20. Keep in mind where we are. Now watch this. What do we mean by the kingdom of God is upon you? Luke chapter 11, verse 20. Look at Luke 11, 20. In Luke 11, Matthew, Mark, Luke. In Luke chapter 11 and verse 20, we see the kingdom of God is upon. You say, what do you mean upon? But if I drive out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has already come upon you. What? If I drive out demons by the finger of God. Have you ever seen this in the Message Bible?
Yeah.
Do we have that at all on computer, the Message Bible?
Send demons
packing. It says, if I drive out demons by the finger of God, you know the kingdom of God has already come upon you. What? What does it mean by the kingdom of God has come upon you? When the kingdom of God is upon you, that means you overcome every demonic activity. If the kingdom of God is upon you, the demons can't be there. Because if the kingdom of God shows up, I mean, demons vanish.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hello, Christopher. Message Bible, amplify it. Something, please, help me out. Jesus, Lord. I'm trying to show you something. You can't just look at the verse. If I drive out demons by the finger of God. So Jesus pointing his finger. Demon, go. What's happening? He's saying the kingdom of God. But if it is God's finger I'm pointing that sends the demons on their way, God's kingdom is here for sure. So we say, how do we know the kingdom of God is here? How do we know the kingdom of God is here? Well, we know demons are leaving. Listen to me, if I'm speaking to you right now and you're feeling irritated, trust me, a demon is the number one thing to make you feel irritated. He's always going to preoccupy you and distract your mind, because right now the only thing that will distract you is a demon. God, if God is in you, God hears God. The Spirit of God inside you is in tune to the voice of God. God hears God. But if in your mind and everything inside you, something else is more important. I know who's talking to you. It's not God. There's nothing inside you. Anything inside you that's saying anything else is more important than the Word of God right now is the devil.
Yep.
If there's anything in your mind saying, you're in the Word of God right now, I have something else more important than the Word of God, it's the devil talking. Because there's nothing more important than the Word of God. There's only one voice that can tell you that something is more important than the Word of God talking right now, and that would be the devil. There is no other voice that can tell you what you're hearing right now is more important than the Word of God, except the devil. Oh, you're all quiet now, amen? Because when the flesh is uncomfortable, it's like, why is it? Because maybe you can't point your finger and send demons packing. And if you can't point your finger and send demons packing, the kingdom of God must not come upon you. Amen. Come on. Are you sending demons packing every day? Are you casting demons out of people every day?
Yes.
Huh? It didn't say these signs shall follow the fivefold ministry. It says these signs shall follow them that believe. They'll cast out devils, heal the sick, and raise the dead. Isn't that right?
Yes.
The kingdom of God is in you. Jesus said, the kingdom of God will come. Where's the kingdom of God? Within you. Now let me explain the difference. There's a difference between the kingdom of God being near, the kingdom of God being upon, and the kingdom of God is what? Within you. Within you. When the kingdom of God is within you, the authority of God rests upon the revelation you have. You can write that down. Write that down real slow if you want to. When the kingdom of God is within you, the authority of God rests upon the revelation you have. If you don't have much revelation, how are you going to do anything? How are you going to explain anything? Well, I don't know. If I pray for people, maybe they'll get healed. Maybe they won't. Why would you say that? Are you not sure you have anything from God? Do you not know what you have inside you? Do you not know what you believe? Come on. Somebody help me. See, that's why we always talk about without faith it's impossible to please God, but he that comes to God must believe that he is. And I've shared this before. The revelation you have of the bigness of God determines the groundwork of your belief. If you don't believe God's that big, well, of course he's not going to do anything big through you. I don't think God's that great. Well, nothing great will happen. You understand what I'm saying? It's only going to happen because you believe he's great. If you believe God's great and he's awesome and he's powerful, he can do something great and awesome through you. Because then you're like, I yield to God's rule and authority in my life to do something impossible, to do something great. Hallelujah. You are awesome, God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I love that.
Amen.
I love that. Now look at this. Watch what happens here in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 16. Listen very carefully. Matthew chapter 3 verse 16. Be a good student tonight, amen? Mm-hmm. Matthew chapter 3 and verse 16. When the students, that's how you, when you set your mind, say, I'm going to learn. And after being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water. Behold, the heavens were opened. The heavens are opened. Now remember we talked about the earth speaking to you. Now the heavens were opened, and I saw the Spirit of God descend like a dove and lighting on him. Who's him? The Word. The Spirit of God came on the Word. The Spirit of God came on the Word. And what happened when the Spirit of God came on the Word? And behold, a voice out of the heaven said, this is my beloved Son. Listen to me. There's what we call the Word and the breath of God and the voice of God. We have to be, Jesus is the Word. And when the Spirit of God came on the Word, you hear the voice. You see, you can be reading it, suddenly you go, that's why a lot of times I read the Bible, I'll pray in tongues. Read the Bible, I'll pray in tongues. Why? Because I want the Spirit of God to tell me what it says. Because who wrote it? The Holy Spirit. It's inspired by the Holy Spirit. It's God breathed.
Yes.
Amen? And for God to breathe, the Spirit of God, the breath of God is in what? Try let me speak without breathing. Can't say one word. It's going to take some breath. Amen? So I need breath to propel words. I need the breath of God, the Spirit of God, to touch the Word of God. And when it does, guess what we have? We have the voice of God that comes forth. Amen? And we have to understand, when the voice of God comes forth, the voice of revelation. One thing I realized is that self-ambition always silences the voice of revelation. Self-ambition silences the voice of revelation. I did it my way. I, me, my. When you put yourself in I, me, my, listen to me, you are shutting down how God wants to talk to you because I am more important than what God might be trying to say. What I want to do right now, what it doesn't matter what it is nothing more important than what God is trying to say.
Amen.
So there's earth communication and there's heaven. Heaven. Look at Isaiah. In Isaiah chapter 6, when the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above it to the seraphim, remember the two they flew, and one cried out to the other and said, Holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. And the post of the door was shaken. Amen. And the glory of God came in. Isaiah said, Woe is me, for I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell amongst a people of unclean lips. So my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And one of the seraphim flew, having in his hand a live coal, which he had taken from the tongs of the altar, placed upon the mount, and said, Behold, your iniquity is taken away from you. Your sin is purged. Whom shall I send? Who will go for me? And Isaiah said, Jeremiah, Lord, send me. He said, Go to these people. Why do you go to these people? Seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear. But if they see and hear, they'll turn and they'll be healed. I just quoted to you the first 17, 18 verses of Isaiah chapter 6. Amen. That's not difficult to do that. You can quote hundreds of verses when you learn to let the Holy Spirit say what he wants to say. Remember, look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. Go with me to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, because I want you to see something, how God wants to connect you to the voice of heaven. Amen. We have what we call the voice that comes around us. And then we have the voice where God wants to speak from heaven. And I love that, because that's real powerful. There's a difference between when Jesus talks to you, when the Holy Spirit talks to you, and God talks to you. I've had a dream before, and they were all through there. When Jesus was there, I mean, you can see him. Amen. When the Holy Spirit is there, it's almost like a transparent man that looks like a figure of a man, but he's there. When God's there, the glory of God, it's like, I cannot explain, the Ancient of Days. It's like someone who's been around for trillions of years, and there is a look and a glory of God, but I've had it in a dream where all three were there. And it was so powerful. But there is a difference. And as you get into the Spirit of God and learn to connect to the things of God, like Paul says, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. I was caught up in the Spirit and heard inexpressible things. Now, this is very important, because God wants to speak to you from around you, but he also wants to speak to you straight from heaven. Ephesians chapter 2. Look what it says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us. Amen. Is that right? Verse 5. Is this Ephesians 2, 4, 5? If I remember the verse, I'm trying to remember exactly where I'm at. Am I in the right place? But God being rich. Okay, verse 6, that's what I want you to see. And he raised us up in him and seated us with him in the heavenly. Really, the word places is not in the Greek. It's in italics, in Christ. So God raised us up and seated us in Christ. Now there's an earth voice where you speak to me. But if I'm seated in the heavenlies, what happens? I will access the heavenly voice. Come on. When I'm in the earth, I hear earthly voice. But where are you seated? Are you seated in the heavenlies?
Yes.
Well, then guess what? Then you need to thank God and say, Lord, thank you. I'm seeing the heavenlies. I can hear conversation in the heavens.
Yes.
I hear the conversations in the heavens.
Yes.
Say after me, say, I hear
the
conversation
in the heavens.
My ears are spiritually in tune. So in the earth, humans speak to each other. A donkey can speak, the elements can speak, the wind in the tree, like David heard, the wind in the tree. There's a pillar of fire, a cloud, all these things. But go with me to 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 11 and 12. Watch this. But God then wants to connect you to the spiritual element. Now, what's the connection? There's earthly revelation, but there's spiritual revelation. There's revelation that connects you to the things of the heavens. Hallelujah. Now, in 1 Kings chapter 19, 1 Kings 19, you'll love this, because sometimes people are trying to talk to us, but we have a difficulty hearing. We're so busy. God is sometimes trying to talk to us straight from heaven, and we struggle to pick it up. This is not complicated. This is simple. Wow. Look at 1 Kings 19, verse 11. So he said, Go forth, stand in the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord was passing by, and a great and strong wind was rending the mountain, breaking in pieces rocks before him. And the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind there was an earthquake. And the Lord was not in the earthquake. Are you ready? I'm going to give you a revelation. Keep going. Verse 12. Watch this. So what did we just see? The Lord was not in the wind. The Lord was not an earthquake, but after the earthquake, a fire. And the Lord was not in the fire. You say, why is this so important? Are you ready? You ready for this case? You're going to love this. What was Elijah used to? Elijah is a man who had control of the elements. Water out of the ground, earthquakes, fire, wind. The guy could tell, it's not going to rain at my command. It doesn't rain for 3.5 years. If I be a man of God, let fire come down for him. Fire comes down and consumes the altar. They come and try to catch him one time. If I be a man of God, 50 men get fried. Actually, 50 or 50, it says, captains. That's a lot more men. Remember, they came to visit him twice. It's probably 50 times 50. Fried.
Fried.
Twice he fried an entire army. The man had such a revelation of fire, when it came time to be taken to heaven, God sent a chariot of fire to take out the man that had a revelation of fire. So this man knew about the earthquakes. Because of time, it says he caused an earthquake to happen and opened the ground. Another time he told the rain to not stop. Another time he called out fire. Man, Elijah was a prophet who had control of the elements.
Amen.
And now God's trying to talk to him. See, there's an earthquake. There's a fire. There's wind. And after the fire, or Sarah, a gentle blowing, or basically, watch this, if you look it up in another translation, a still, small voice. The word gentle blowing there means a breeze, a still, small voice. Give this to me and amplify it for a second. Watch this. A still, small voice. Amen. Hallelujah. And these things are like really simple. Watch this. After the great fire, 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 gentle stillness, and a still, what? This is the man who had power over the elements. Avatar has nothing on him. Amen. Wind, fire, rain, this guy could do it all. He was the Avatar, Elijah. Hallelujah. Amen. Come on. This guy had control of the elements.
Yes.
A little quiet. But it's all in the Bible. The Avatar didn't come up with this stuff. Amen. God thought about this stuff long ago. Hallelujah. Amen. But it took one woman, Jezebel, to break the flow of revelation. To make him forget how he could send a storm down on her. Maybe he could send down fire and fry Jezebel if he wanted to. But I don't know why he didn't call down fire on Jezebel. Suddenly this woman says, I'm going to kill you. And he's like, eh. And when he gets afraid, he can't call fire down on that woman. Can you believe that Jezebel will freeze people, put people in a place of fear? And most of the time, people can't receive revelation and receive what God has because they're afraid. How many times have you not been able to do something? Can't jump off a cliff, can't go skydiving, whatever it is. You know what I'm talking about? You can't do a challenge because of fear. I remember when I was a little kid, I was out swimming in the ocean and a friend of mine, a shark came and he hit the shark in the nose and off the shark went. I thought, well, whoopee doopee, shark king, and another thing comes your way, you just hit him in the nose. So I would swim past all the waves. I'm 12 years old. I swam about 2 miles into the ocean. The next thing you know, the undercurrent was so powerful I could never get back to shore. I was stuck out there for an hour and a half, 2 hours, and I wasn't coming back. And my uncle and them were looking at binoculars. Next thing you know, they got a speedboat. My uncle was like, when they looked from afar, there were sharks swimming all around me. Well, I didn't think anything of it. So they came all the way with the boat, picked me up. They were like, get out of the water, get out of the water. There were sharks everywhere. I get in the boat. They said to me, were you afraid? I was like, no, I wasn't afraid. They're like, you were not afraid? Because if you were afraid, they were going to eat you up. Now you see, fear is attracted to fear. Fear is attracted to fear. So what happens is that day, they were like, you're not afraid. And my uncle was sitting there sweating bullets going, somehow, I don't even know how you made it because there was like 20 sharks all around you. And he was like, but you see, me, I wasn't afraid. He said, but if you fear, the body will release chemicals from the body to say you're freer. And remember, Satan is attracted to Satan. Like fear is attracted to fear. So there's certain things where things can speak, but there's certain things that isolate and stop revelation. But he moved him into heavenly revelation. And when this voice came, guess what happened? He had the anointing to give Elisha a double portion of the anointing. So powerful. A still small voice. See, it wasn't a place of his familiarity. God spoke to him, this time to Elijah, not like he did before.
Amen.
No fire, no lightning, no wind. Huh? A still small whisper. That was not the familiarity for Elijah. You say, what am I trying to say? You know what I wrote down? I wrote down this after God spoke me this. He said, there's no imitation for revival. Don't imitate a revival you had before. Sometimes he said, we know certain things. Oh, I'm going to do revival like the Pensacola revival. And everyone's going to run to the altar and repent every day. And if they're not repenting, it's just not revival. Well, I'm going to do it like so and so, where everyone is just falling on the ground, laughing every meeting, laughing every meeting. If everybody's not drunk and laughing in the Holy Ghost, it's not revival. And come on. Everybody's quiet. Just trying to make you think. And so God did something here that wasn't the normal. What I'm trying to say is, let God talk to you outside of your parameter of trying to hear God. Well, this is the way I do it. I go to my bedroom, I read my Bible, I pray this certain way. And, hey, has that been working for you? The way you're reading your Bible, the way you're praying, it's really working for you? If God is really talking to you every day and you're really making progress? If you're in a stalemate and you're going in a circle and not much is happening, I suggest you find a new way to hear the voice of God. I suggest you change the way you pray. I suggest you get full of the Holy Spirit and start talking in tongues. I suggest you start doing something. Hallelujah. Amen. Come on. You know, because this is important. And it's just, you know, it's interesting. Wow. I started realizing that we don't just need that. We need to be in that place where we literally announce and say, I am the voice of God. Because I think God wants to speak through you more than he wants to speak to you. Oh, you're quiet. Ready? Must I give you a revelation? God wants to speak through you more than he wants to speak to you. Oh, let me say it again. God wants to speak through you more than he wants to speak to you.
Yes.
Well, let me say that phrase again. Must I say it again? God wants to speak through you more than he wants to speak to you. I mean, when God speaks through me, I know God is talking to me already. I'm like, sometimes when God's speaking through me, I go, wow, how did I come up with that? That's amazing. I better take notes on my own sermon. I was like, this is incredible. How did I say that? Where did that come from? I know it didn't come from me. I'm just like, oh, there's many times I've been preaching, I'm sitting down and I'm writing down stuff that God's saying. And I'm like, how did I even think of that? I know I didn't get that in the Bible. God must have just told me that. Wow, that's amazing. But was he trying to speak to me? No, he was speaking through me. God wants to speak through you more than he wants to speak to you. I am the voice of God.
Yes.
Ooh. I am revival. I am kingdom. I'm righteous.
Yes.
I'm joint heirs. I'm complete. Well, who remembers what the I am was yesterday? No? No? What was yesterday's I am? Let me see if anybody can remember it.
I am revelation.
I am revelation.
So that's what Steve just said.
Oh, good girl. Today, just say, I am the voice of God. Some people, the only voice that they hear from God is you. Do you know that? Some people, the only voice of God that they hear is you. Because they don't even know what it's like to hear God. That's called earthbound revelation. God speaking through you in earth, person to person. Hallelujah. Now in Acts, now watch this. God in the Old Testament used to speak to people from the outside. But in the New Testament, God now speaks on the inside. Well, let me give it to you again. In the Old Testament, God talked through the fire, talked through the wind, talked through the pillar, talked through this, talked, come on. Talked through the prophet Nathan, talked everywhere else. Hallelujah. Wow, I forgot about that. Amen. That's a David Newberry one. Hallelujah. So in the Old Testament, God spoke on the outside. But in the New Testament, guess where God wants to talk to you? On the inside. On the inside. Give me Acts chapter 2. Are you ready, Christopher? Acts chapter 2. Watch this. Watch this. Acts chapter 2. Are you ready? Now, this is where God marries the two. He takes the voice from this realm, horizontal, and the voice from the vertical. And in Pentecost, he puts it all together.
Come on.
And he said, Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven. I was just going to quote it anyhow until you got there. Amen. Suddenly there came a what? From heaven, a noise like a violent rushing wind. Outside noise. Watch out this. Watch what he does. And it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues like as a fire, distributing or resting on each of them. Pillar of fire. Wind. David says, Lord, should I pursue my enemy? Should I take my enemy over? Lord, should I go fight against my enemy? David's asking God, should I destroy my energy? Hey, boys, should I destroy my enemy? Should I fight against you? David's asking God, should he do it? And guess what God said? When you hear the wind blowing in the mulberry trees, who's with me? When you see the wind, you'll what? Pursue God. Go for it. Destroy the enemy. And the wind began to blow. And God began to, David was able to do what he did. Ready? Look what it says. And there appeared to them what? Divided tongues like as fire, distributing and rested upon them. Ready? Go with me to verse 4. Watch this. Verse 4. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the what?
Spirit
gave them utterance. Now there were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when the sound occurred, the crowd came together and were bewildered because, why was the crowd bewildered? Because each one of them who was hearing them speaking in his own language. They were what? Speaking in his what?
Own language.
Come on, where did this happen? How did many languages come about? What was God saying yet? The Spirit, when the Holy Spirit came upon these people who were Jews, they began to speak in many languages. Now, many people who could not understand the things of the Spirit, this is revelation from heaven now invading the earth. Revelation from heaven now is invading the earth. Are you with me? I mean, someone couldn't understand what you were saying, but because the Holy Spirit is on you, now you might not have been able to talk German, you can talk German. This is what happened in Topeka, Kansas in 1901. They were trying to study the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came down. A lady began to speak fluent Chinese. When she spoke fluent Chinese, she started writing Chinese. So Brother Parham says, my God, the lady can write Chinese, speak Chinese. Let's send her to China. And they spent months studying Acts chapter 1 and Acts chapter 2 to find out, is tongues from God or not? And then suddenly the power of God came in the place. They all started speaking in tongues. And one lady started talking Chinese. Another lady started talking this language, that language. So the lady who was talking Chinese, she not only talked Chinese, she started writing Chinese. She never studied Chinese. She never learned Chinese. But now she could speak Chinese. So they sent her to China and she became a great missionary. And the way we know the truth of that is from Gwen Shaw and other people who went to China later on. And even from Watchman Nee knew this lady, because that's what influenced Watchman Nee. Gwen Shaw, many of these people through end time managers, when they went to China, find out the way that this came into China was through this lady.
Wow.
Who didn't know no Chinese or couldn't write in Chinese. And it was how? By the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Can you believe the Holy Spirit could do that?
Yes.
Make you learn a language instantly in one day.
Amen.
That you've never spoken before and even written it. Now, where did this start? Well, this started in Genesis chapter 11. If you look in Genesis chapter 11, verse 1, go with me to Genesis chapter 11, verse 1. Let me try to do this as quick as I can, and I want you to just get this just a little bit here. Watch this now. Because this is where God came. Genesis chapter 11. I want you to see this. There's a difference between Revelation coming one way and Revelation coming another way. Hallelujah. Now, Genesis chapter 11, verses 1. Now, the whole earth used the same language and the same words. Can you believe it? But it came about as they journeyed eastward that they found a plain in the land of Shur and settled it. And they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and burn them through and use these bricks of stone. They use it hard. Look at verse 4. And what are they going to do? Now, verse 4. And they said, come, let us build for ourselves a city, a tower to top, to reach into the heavens, and let us make for ourselves a name. You know, people are still trying to reach into the heavens. Still trying to find our own way to get into the heavens. This is what I call the escape mentality. We have this upward mentality. Oh God, get us out of here. Let's escape. You know what I mean? Let's build this tower. Let's make a name for ourselves. And what happens is this escape mentality, they always want to go upward. Let's just go upward. Hallelujah. Seems to me the upward idea of just going upward like that was an old idea. Amen. The idea was to go upward and not go outward. But God didn't want them to go upward. God wanted them to go what? Outward. Somebody's going to get the revelation. Are you ready? God didn't want them to go upward. God wanted them to go outward. They're so heavenly minded. You've heard the saying. They're so heavenly minded. They're no earthly good. That's not true. Because God wants you to minister out of the heavens to the earth. He doesn't want you to go to the heavens. He wants you to minister from being seated in the heavens to the earth. He wants you to be able to have tongues and interpretation of tongues. He wants you to be able to pray in the Spirit to access a vertical, who's with me, a vertical revelation to bring forth horizontal revelation. And when you get vertical revelation down, horizontal revelation will flow. It's not like you're trying to go somewhere. Huh? Come on. Heaven comes down.
Yeah.
Amen. The Bible says God gave the earth and the nations are our inheritance. Amen.
Amen.
The nations are our inheritance. The righteous will inherit the earth. The wicked are being removed. Well, of course, they always want to go up. They want out of here. Amen. See, Pentecost does something. When the power of the Holy Spirit comes in, it gives us back the language of revelation. And it gives us back the language of relevance. You say, what do you mean by relevant? When I never spoke Chinese, and now I can speak and write in Chinese, and I can tell people about Chinese, what happens? Now the power of the Holy Spirit, what came from heaven, becomes relevant.
Yes.
Do you understand what I mean? If I went to Germany and I couldn't speak German, but the Holy Spirit touched me, and the power of God came upon me, now I can speak fluent German, I can write in German, I can tell them about Jesus, then the power of the Holy Spirit becomes relevant to the earth. It becomes real. And when it becomes relevant, you can touch the nations.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
And so God wants the Holy Spirit to become so real in your life that you'll be able to touch people around you. Not to go upwards. We're going to go and build our own kingdom. We're going to do it ourselves. No, I, me, and my independence will stop revelation so far. Oh, God is trying to say something so powerful.
Thank you, Lord.
Go ahead, Mom. She's on a roll. I can feel it. She's about to. Go ahead. Give Mom volume. Hallelujah.
I'm reminded of two incidents that this is an example, we were in revival and I was worshiping and all of a sudden as I was worshiping, it was like stop and pray in tongues. And I did, I stopped and prayed in tongues. And there was a girl, somewhere in Iowa. And there was a girl sitting in the front. And afterwards, she came up to me and she said, do you know French? I said, I don't know French. She said, you spoke fluent French to me, and I heard God speak to me. And now my life has changed. Amen. And I know during that same meeting, Warren was preaching, and he stopped and prayed, and the Spirit stopped, and a lady from Israel. Same
God,
thing.
God gave me a word. I just suddenly started talking and I did not know. And the lady said, God was talking to you through me. And I said, I was just talking in tongues. I said, I don't know what I was saying at all. She said, well, you were speaking fluent Hebrew. And this lady was Jewish. She ended up getting saved full of the Holy Ghost. Her whole life got changed. And she said, I heard God talk to you through Hebrew. How did you learn Hebrew? I said, I never learned Hebrew. I don't know how to speak Hebrew. Same thing happened with the lady from Yugoslavia. I was in a meeting, I was just like so brepete and losing and gandan emotion. I just started talking in tongues. And the lady in God started talking to this lady, and she said, I was speaking fluent Yugoslavian. And I said, I don't know Yugoslavian, but God talked to her.
Amen. What I got from what he was saying about the natural and the supernatural coming together, both are God's creation. And when we submit the natural to the supernatural, power is released. Amen. God's power is released. And then, which is a drawing card for drawing people to Him. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you.